I'm Allison Rogers. I'm the editor here of Collision Repair Magazine. And today we've got an hour-long session for you. We're going to be talking about training in collision repair industry. Obviously, things have been tough for a long time. We are facing a lot of challenges right now, and it's a new year. We can experience all of the wealth that the new year has to offer. And we're going to be talking about everything that Spanesi has to offer as well. So before we get started, I'm very familiar with your background, Tim. Some of our viewers here might be as well, but could you tell us a little bit about just your background in the collision repair industry and how you work with Spanesi Americas?
Well, you said I've been in this my whole life. Basically, my first experience with collision repair was with my neighbor who had a small body shop behind his house at the age of 14. I started sanding my first car. And learning, and you know, I was learning on 1970s vehicles, if that gives you a little date. Over the period of years, I been a body shop manager for a dealership. I had my own body shop for over 10 years, sold that business, went into education, and I was an educator at a technical college in Cleveland, Ohio. For a number of years, and then I got into the equipment business in about 1996. Started out as a trainer with a large equipment company, and with that large equipment company, I moved all the way up to be the global director of training. And then with growing pains, decided to move on and manage businesses. And this is the third business operation that I've been a part of. And actually, this one I started in its infancy. So I've been with Spanesi now. We're in our 10th year here. Started at zero and worked our way up for growth in North and South America as my responsibilities. So yeah, as you said, I've seen it all. I've traveled the world for collision repair. Spent considerable amount of time in Asia. Setting up some operations in China, other parts of the world, India, Malaysia, Thailand, Germany, France, Sweden, Italy, obviously, with the Spanesi family. So I have a pretty well-rounded education of what education needs for collision repair, not to mention I'm still out in the shop. Trying to work with technicians. I'm not the kind of person that likes to sit still. So I'm out every chance I get in the shop working with people to make them excel in their business or in the processes that they're doing. And I still go out and help with repairs if I need to. And sometimes I just stumble along a repair that I want to help with. So.
Yeah. So, I mean, you mentioned you've been in equipment since 1996, and that might not seem like a long time for some people, but that is 26 years. That's a long time to be dealing with equipment, not to mention you've been in the body shop before that. So, I mean, you've seen a lot of transitions from equipment in the 90s to what we're dealing with now in 2022.
Well, I've been, like I said, I'm soon to be 60. So if you take 14 from 60, that'll tell you I've been doing this 46 years.
Exactly. So exactly. Incredible. But I just know that so many people will look back and be like, oh, the 90s feel like yesterday. No, it's actually a long time, folks. I was born in the 90s. So it's been a long time since, I mean, we're not getting into age or anything like that, but you know what I mean? It's been a long time, and Tim knows his stuff. He's been experienced in seeing all this stuff. And like you said, he's in the body shop off quite frequently. When we try to get in touch with Tim, a lot of the time it's like, oh, he's in Hawaii at the body shop there. So Tim's got a lot of experience here and has witnessed a lot. And that being said, obviously in 2022, speaking to shops, witnessing what we've been through in the past 2 years of the pandemic, there's a lot of discussion about trends, challenges. So what are some of the things you've seen from shops that you've been speaking with so far in 2022? What are the things that they're really challenged with right now?
Well, I think there's a few challenges that we have out there. Challenges of having the correct labor people in your facility, or having even enough people to be able to do the job. It seems that there was a shortage of technicians before, you know, we even went through this past 2 years with this pandemic, or whatever you want to call it. But we were hurting for technicians coming into the trade before, you know, things happened. in the industry, and now it's even worse. Every day I'm getting a call from a shop owner, shop manager. It's like, hey, do you got any technicians? Do you know where I can find a good person, you know, that does framework, or even, you know, because we also handle spray booths. It's like, I need a painter, you know? And so I think we have to look at the technician shortage. We also know that there's some supply chain issues right now. So when we look at the supply chain issues, now, do we have to look at, is there a way to possibly repair something safely within the guidelines of what the OEM says to be able to do instead of replacing it? Because the time of how long it's going to take to have to wait for the part and keep a customer in a rental is excessive. So maybe we need to look at looking at a repair plan instead of a replacement plan. Training is an issue, big issue right now in the industry, because trying to get to people in the masses is not always easy. We have people that travel around all around the world that is their job to be able to do training. But I have to tell you, in the past 24 months, a lot of those doors were closed to us. We weren't allowed in those facilities. We weren't allowed to travel to those different areas. And it's kind of, you know, put the brakes on for not just our company. I think everybody in every business in the world, when you start to look at how are we going to train the masses and be able to get back to where we were prior to this disruption. And then that's why we've taken some advances to be able to, that's why we're sitting in the studio here today. And so, I mean, when you start to look at that, I also look at a lot of times when we're trying to work with a technician, if we could not be on that telephone and we could be looking face to face like we are right now, and be able to communicate better, see what each other is doing. And also, as we have across the way in the building next door, another studio that is live with all the equipment operating in it, to be able to go do the demonstration right there.
Well, yeah, that's, you just spit out a lot of information, of course. Yes, those are all the things that shops are dealing with. I know repair versus replace is a big thing right now too. And I want to get back to that perhaps later in the discussion, but training. Yeah, it's been, especially here with, I know that perhaps in the States, it's not as stringent with the lockdowns and stuff, but we're still dealing with lockdowns up here in Canada. Like, we have another one in Ontario that's just being lifted next Monday, or at least progressing to the next stage. These are things that a lot of people in Canada have not been in the training centers or had been in a training environment for 2 years, and it's just starting to get back to normal. So that being said, just starting to get back to normal, do you foresee this continuation of a virtual aspect going forward? I mean, you've built your studios and everything. Do you think that this is going, people are going to continue demanding virtual over in person?
I really do think that we can be more accommodating to our customer or to the industry. If we offer I'll call it a hybrid, mm-hmm. because we'll never stop doing hands-on. We're still going to have to be in the shops when customers need us. But we also need an alternative, and our alternative is going to be able to do events like this, not just, you know, to talk about a situation, but we want to be able to actually, if there is a situation, how do you want your training done? Is it something that your technicians just need a refresher, that maybe we don't have to have the expense of a trainer traveling somewhere? And then we can, if we're actually doing it from a format like this, we have the ability to be able to get 4 or 5 shops together. No one has had to put out any expense for the travel, or even it's not just the expense for the travel, it's the time that it takes. And especially if you look at from your Atlantic to your Western of Canada, the timing to go from one end to the other is huge. And the stops that you have to make along the way. I think that this virtual format that we've put together, I think you're going to see more companies moving this direction. Again, will we ever get rid of in-person? You can't. You always have to have hands-on. But we've also looked at, when we're developing programs, that as we're doing the program, is there a way that we can put up some questions? Is there a way that we could actually have them go do the process? And then come back and answer questions about the lab process that we just asked them to do with the equipment that they're working with.
So with the online training that Spanesi offers, it's, you can do group settings, one-on-one, virtual. I mean, if someone wants something at the drop of a hat, you're able to help them with that kind of support.
Well, with the way we've been able to set this up, besides using the studios, I mean, if someone needs something, I mean, we can set up a camera in our studio, our training studio, if you want to call it, and, you know, set the laptop right next to it and be able to, you know, discuss everything, walk through how to be able to use a piece of equipment. Actually, we've even used it to do a product demonstration for someone who was so far remote that they were like, there's no way I can get there for about 60 days, but I really need to know about this. So we take them remote and on a one-on-one setting, and we walk through how to be able to use the equipment, show them what all the settings are to be able to do it, have them make test welds for us that we're able to visually see through the format that we're using, and also be able to share from on our end. If you looked at what we did with our interactive week that we did back in October, it was very well received. We did a lot of hands-on demonstrations during that week, besides supporting the industry with not just things about Spanesi. We had some roundtables with some OEMs to where we were able to share some OEM information that probably would not have been released to the public in any other format the way we did it. Then if you look at also being able to, the people that you're dealing with when you call in here for technical support, when you call in here for training, or you're go into an interactive mode, we've all done this stuff. So you're dealing with experienced people that actually can make the equipment do what it's supposed to do, or the process that you're doing.
Sorry, we got a comment here saying that the people might be having trouble hearing me. So let me know if anyone's having trouble hearing either myself or Tim, just let us know in the Q&A or in the comments and we can adjust accordingly. But yeah, to your point, Tim, I think a key, something that when we were talking about this webinar and discussions that obviously clicked in my brain was, a lot of the time when you're dealing with customer service agents, people don't know what, I mean, there's someone outsourced from another country, sometimes overseas, and they don't know actually what they're talking about. And let me get connected to this person. You get connected 14 different times. We had one of our columnists write about the same subject in a recent issue of Collision Repair Mag. So I think it's a key point here that when you call Spanesi, I mean, how fast would your, I mean, maybe we don't have numbers for this right now, but it's pretty simple. It's pretty fair to say that the issue will be rectified faster than someone that would be outsourced or the typical customer service.
Well, I can tell you, when it comes to our customer service, every call that comes into our location here, so all our calls in North America come through this office. Every single one of them is documented in our CRM system. And there's a timer clicking. But we actually have the system set up that I'm even notified for every ticket that comes in, so I can watch or follow what's actually happening. So, and I can tell you from looking at the timers of how things are taken care of, it's within minutes. If you're waiting longer than an hour, that must mean that there's a lot of people that are, you know, it's a Monday morning or something and everybody went home on Friday and forgot to, you know, send us a message early. But typically within 30, 35 minutes, everything's cleared up and taken care of. And a lot of the calls that we get are just, hey, it's been a while since I used the system. Or, you know, I'm a new person. Can you help me get from, you know, A to say Z? and we log in with them in their computer and interactively work with them to be able to get them going. Every once in a while, somebody hasn't done their update, so we'll go and help them through an online portal to be able to update their system. So, but I can tell you, we track every single call that comes in this building. We work hard to make sure that our customers taken care of in a timely fashion. Now, that being said, we're on central time. So again, looking at Canada, we have some time constraints of, you know, how much time we're available for the people on the West Coast and how much time we're available for the people on the East Coast.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And the other thing that people probably don't even realize, and I'm not even sure if some of my employees even realize that, but if you dial in here after hours and you need help, the phone message will get forwarded to my mobile phone 24/7.
Oh my goodness. Wow. So you're never disconnected. And you're saying you get a ticket every time that a case is open or something. It's kind of like, would you say you monitor kind of KPIs on that? And if something were to seem like out of whack or something, you would check up and make sure that that customer was taking
care of. We do a lot of KPIs here. Not just that, okay, how many times has a customer called in for the same type of thing? But how many times has the customer called in and maybe it's been two or three technicians that have called in? It sounds like we have a training issue there that maybe we need to go back out to the shop or get with the shop to be able to get in an online setting and give them some, you know, some remedial training to be able to have them be able to function better. Some of the other things that we look at, if we get, it happens, I mean, a car missing in a database. We can, from the calls that come in, know what's the highest priority of vehicle that we need to be able to get in and measure and source the vehicle. Some of the other things that you'll find is at the end of your online session with us, or even if it's through an email, we're going to send you a survey to be able to, in that survey, tell us how we did. And there's a set of reports that come out every Sunday morning, and over a coffee, I sit there and review what happened the week before, and then we figure out what we have to do next week to be better, or is there people that we still have to follow up with? So we take our customer service and our training seriously.
Well, I mean, it sounds like it. Like I've been calling it Spanesi Hollywood Studios, which we've been having a laugh about. But I mean, you've invested a lot of time and effort into, and money, obviously, into this studio. And I mean, you're saying you're sitting in studio four today? Four?
Yes, this is our fourth one. We did, we have classroom setting. So if we're going to have multiple people in the classroom and also be able to go live, we have, we've set a spray booth up as a studio to be able to, if need be, to be able to go in and teach our own internal people or our distribution about maintenance of a spray booth. We're even thinking about launching a class in the spray booth of how to be able to properly maintain it. And then we have studio that is the training center studio where you can actually go live and you can weld, you can measure, you can pull cars. So we can do everything there. And then we have this oversized, studio, and I don't know if Carl can flip cameras to, camera number two. Well, you can see the pilot who's hidden behind the, down there behind the microphone, just waving a little bit, with the control center to be able to run everything that we have going here, from the lighting to shading to, exactly what you're going to see. And beyond that, we're now using some new software to be able to bring audio in and multiple sources externally. Matter of fact, we have a dry run we're going to do as soon as we're done with this one today with some people from BASF. So we're working with other industry partners to be able to try and bring not just to our customers, but to the industry as a whole, It's something that the Spanesi family and including myself have always looked at. How can we help the industry and be able to make things easier? And as you start to look at, you know, what we've been all been through in the past 24 months, and you're talking about restrictions, we still have plenty of restrictions across the U.S. here. I don't see it going away anytime soon. And it was about, I'd have to say mid-2020, it was like, what are we going to do? Our phones are ringing like crazy because we can't be in the facility. We have to come up with an alternative. And we worked and worked, and then we came up with Interactive Week for October of 21. By the time we got, you know, some of the studio put together and you know, some of the equipment purchases made. We launched that. We learned a lot from that, I'd have to say. We know we need backup laptops. We need backup batteries, backup cameras, backup lenses.
The real world of video production. Yep.
Even this morning, it was like, I think we need one more component or two more components. It's like, how do we get this, you know? But I really think when you look at the industry, it's what the industry needs. There's a lot of people out there in the industry that need help. And I think from this format that we've put together, like I said, it's not just going to be all Spanesi. It's going to be, what does the industry need? One of the seminars that we did or segments that we did in Interactive Week was how to attract people into our industry. That goes back to what we, you know, I talked about first when you start to talk about the labor force. And if we're getting a younger labor force in, younger people are on their computers all day long. So this interactive stuff that we put together is right up their, you know, their mainstream, and what they're used to. And I can tell you, just watching in my own family, two students at home trying to struggle through virtual school for about a year. And even as of two weeks ago, a junior in college, having to take her classes back from home again because they weren't going to be in person. And it's like, okay, we're on that same path, but we still want to be able to be in the shop.
Mm-hmm. Well, when things are so uncertain, I think you're absolutely right. It is critical that the industry has a partner like this that is willing to offer training. And like you said, with other partners, it's not just all Spanesi or anything like that. So I would fully agree. But you, perfect segue back to the skills shortage. I know we have some questions in the comments here that we will get to in a minute here when we are back to Q&A. We'll start our Q&A around 2:30. But we've got, obviously, skills shortage has been impending for a while. This has been something that was pre-pandemic on our dockets already. And a lot of efforts have gone into promoting, you know, collision repair among the youth and whatnot. But I know we've had conversations before about how we need to reach them earlier and, you know, high school events and whatnot. What are some things that Spanesi has done, as well as, you know, how can the everyday collision repair shop, the everyday collision repair center owner or technician help contribute to this mission and help solve the skills shortage?
I honestly think if a shop manager, shop owner, and even a technician has even an hour a week that they can donate, mm-hmm. 1 hour a week that they could donate to one of the local schools in their area that teaches collision repair, to go in and be side by side with these students that are already in a collision repair program. But better yet, the owners and managers need to invest maybe a little bit more time going into the school prior to them making a decision. Students start to make their decision of what they want to do. I remember when I was growing up, 5-6 years old, I was fascinated with cars. Everything was about cars. It progressed me to move into the automotive business. I was actually told by our guidance counselor, that I shouldn't go into collision repair. when I was in high school, and my parents had to fight the school board to be able to get me into that program. I was told, go to college. You know, I have some college experience, but I didn't want to be an accountant. I didn't want to be a lawyer. I didn't want to be that. I wanted to work with these. I wanted to work with my hands. And I see that from, I think we're almost too late by starting to talk to them when they're in ninth grade or even 10th grade. They're already molded by then of what they want to do with their life, I think. I think we really need to get into the middle school segment now. And at the same time, in the middle school segment, I think, and I'm not going to talk as a professional educator because I'm not, but I did work at a college for about 4 or 5 years. So I have some experience from the college level, but I really think they need to adjust the teaching trends to be able to help guide the younger people into the trade, realizing that it is a good trade to be in. There are plenty of students that may have a brilliant mind, but would rather work with their hands. And I just think that there needs to be more input from in the education standpoint earlier on so that they can pick the career. Shop visits, invite the local school to your facility to show them that the body shop today, collision repair facility today, is not what you've seen 10 years ago. We just finished a beautiful facility about 5-6 miles from here. It has white floors, white walls. And I know it's a new shop, everything's nice and shiny, but it's going to stay that way. And if you start to look at what's out there, there's a lot of opportunity out there. And it's not like you have to be the person that's going to, you know, do the collision repair or the painting. Maybe you want to be in the parts department. There's parts opportunities. There's adjuster opportunities. There's appraiser opportunities. There's management opportunities. There's plenty of place to go in collision repair. Not everyone has to think that they're going to end up being that body tech their whole life. I see in social media a lot of times people turn around and saying, well, I'm 40. What am I going to do now? And it's like, whoa, 40. I'm heading towards 60. And, you know, I don't have the same position I had when I started when I was 14. I can tell you that. Anything's possible if you put your mind to it.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, to the point that you're saying, if shop owners or managers have 1 hour a week, like maybe take some techs or some painters out. If you have an apprentice, that's a great opportunity to connect someone that's, you know, close in age to the people that you're speaking to and really, you know, share the glory of collision repair with them.
And I really think the younger generation needs to have more affirmative information sooner than in the past. So going into a facility, maybe looking at what they're working on, looking at the projects that they're doing, you know, give them some, you know, give them a little pat on the back that, hey, you're doing a good job here, or I see progress. Right down to the fact that, you know, maybe take them on in your facility. But I can tell you this, if you do bring them into your facility, please don't hand them just a broom. You need to be able to let them grow their skill set. And I think traditionally, and I remember back in the day when I started as an apprentice and I had a guy that I was under, he was like, yeah, first of all, you don't want to be in this business. You're never going to make any money. And I'm like, well, you've been here 30 years. How could that be? You think you would have left already. And you turn around and you have to be able to give them some tasks that they can handle. Obviously, they have to learn. They're not going to be able to, you know, put the frame rail on the first day they're there. But they need to learn those tasks. And mentoring is just that. You need to give them positive reinforcement and try not to hold them back. You'd be surprised how quick people learn, especially if they're in a happy place.
Mm-hmm. You're in a good working environment and a
right
place with a healthy work culture. Absolutely. So yeah, to your point, no brooms, no bullying either, but you know, that stands as it is. We like to poke fun. That's just our industry. Anyway, we also talked about repair versus replace things, part shortages across the board right now. Some people are saying it might not even let up until 2023. In that case, a lot of people are having to repair versus replace. What are your observations? Do you think that the average collision shop is prepared to take this on and, you know, do more repairs versus replacements? Or what's your advice to people in times like this?
Well, I think we need to look at, when we look at repair and replace, we've even gotten calls from vehicle manufacturers that says, we feel that from the data that we're getting back from the industry, that there are too many people replacing quarter panels instead of trying the option of straightening it first. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, in our studios, we actually, for that manufacturer, brought in a couple of their vehicles. We created a video for them to be able to share with their certified collision shops of how to properly be able to straighten the quarter panel on, you know, the particular vehicles, so that they would be educated enough to know that there are some other tooling options should they want to take that method, that they could be able to straighten that quarter panel, for instance, instead of having to replace it. And if I look at that instance, if I'm straightening that quarter panel instead of replacing it, I don't have as much of an evasive repair. I'm turning around and I'm not welding on the vehicle, so I don't have to worry about damaging my corrosion protection. That's all going to stay in place. And when I'm talking about the repair process, I'm talking about using a glue system. To be able to, so as I'm putting my pads on to be able to pull the panel or remove the dent, I'm not heating the panel up. I'm not forcing any electric through the panel, which may cause a problem with some of the sensors on the vehicle or some computer on the vehicle. So we see a lot of opportunities, especially with the, our pull-up systems that are out there, to be able to facilitate some repairs instead of someone having to wait. I talked to a customer the other day, a shop I was in. He had to wait 60 days for a quarter panel. Customer was without their car for nearly three months. And obviously there was not 3 months of rental coverage for that customer. So in those kind of cases, what do you do? And the other thing that I found just last week out doing a demonstration with one of our pull-up systems is they pulled out a brand new quarter panel for a vehicle and it had a dent in it. So here now we have a brand new part that also has a dent in it. If I send it back, how much longer am I going to have to wait for the second part to get there? Is it simpler just to repair that dent, then be able to put the quarter panel on, acknowledging to the customer that, yes, I did have to repair this new panel that I put on. And it's all in the documentation. If you take pictures, you show it. If it's a process that's approved by the vehicle manufacturer, should be no problem with that. So we're also working to put courses together to be able to help with the repair versus replace decisions.
Yeah, and of course, that's another place where training falls into is very important. I mean, how are you going to replace or repair this bumper if you don't have the proper training credits to back up what the manufacturer is asking of you?
Right. And especially if you look at the glue systems that are out there today, there are several different systems that's out there, several that work at several different strengths. Ours does more than it moves into the structural repair area because it being able to pull up to 6 tons in certain situations. So if I take a look at that, there's a lot more repairability out there than it may have been used to in the past, but it is a technique. It doesn't matter what system that you use. It is a technique for you to get used to, okay, when is the glue ready to pull? If you don't give it enough time to be able to set, it may peel off. If you wait too long, it may peel off and not get a good pull. So it is something that takes some experience to get used to.
And these aren't techniques that are going to be going anywhere anytime soon. I mean, we're just witnessing the rises of glue repair now. So these are techniques you're going to want to get on board with.
Well, and especially because, like I said, I'm not getting into the corrosion protection. I'm not having to cut a cut a panel off the car and weld it back on. And then if you look at some of the electric dent pulling systems that are out there, where it would put a stud on the vehicle or a piece of wiggle wire on the vehicle, I now have, I've welded that stud to the car. So I now have all this corrosion protection that's burned behind the panel. With a glue type pulling system, you don't have that. And in certain instances, you can't get to the back of the panel without having to remove interior stuff. So I'm saving time, but not having to dismantle a lot of the car also.
Mm-hmm. So staying up to date and in tune with this training is integral, as well as keeping in touch with your auto manufacturers and making sure that, you know, if you're certified for any of these people, I mean, even if you're not, repairing to the standards, always, you're always repairing to automaker standards and keeping up your training in align with that. So at the grassroots of pretty much everything we've talked about here today, the repair versus replace trends, part shortages, skills shortage, it really is knowledge and training. Do you think that, I mean, like I said, a lot of shops up here in Canada haven't been in the training center for 2 years. Would you say in your experience that the majority of body shops are aptly prepared to take the modern repairs of tomorrow on, or would you say there's still some, obviously some work to be done?
Well, I know there was a survey done by General Motors, probably about 18 months ago to 2 years. And it is probably still about the same, that about 80% of the vehicles being repaired, they were not following the instructions or didn't know where to get the instructions. Unfortunately, with certain manufacturers, you have to buy the data to be able to get the repair information. But that should be a billable, something that goes on to the repair. If I have to purchase that information or have a subscription somehow, that's a tool, that's a cost. So we need to look at how can we recover that from our customer. There is so much information out there, and there are processes that change. So it's not to say that you could buy it 1 year and not the next year, because it could be the same type of vehicle, and a process change. I know the F-150 processes have changed along the way. And if you joined us, in October in our interactive week, we had Jerry Benani from Ford on. And he explained that, yes, there's been a few different changes in repair procedures. So you always have to be on the cutting edge. We have to look at the vehicle safety and the safety of our customers in those vehicles. And if we're not looking at that first, we have a problem.
Yeah, customer comes first. I mean, at the end of the day, if something goes wrong, God forbid, knock on wood, it's who's it going to fall on? That's the question.
Well, it can fall all the way down to the technician, but a lot of technicians don't realize that.
Yeah, exactly. So this is why training is so important, folks. And I know that a lot of the people tuning in today are already, you know, in tune with this message, but.
Well, here's one adage that I've said all along in my life since I started public speaking was, if I turn around and I go into an operating room as a patient, there's a doctor, how many lives are at stake? Mm-hmm. One, mm-hmm. The person getting operated on. Mm-hmm. If I take a vehicle and improperly repair that vehicle and I put it out on the street, how many lives are at stake? The driver, the passengers, and everyone around that vehicle's exterior.
Could be an unlimited number.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So correct repairs following OEM procedures is a must.
Mm-hmm. It's a no questions asked today. I mean, if you're going to be doing collision repair, that's how you should be doing it today. So I know we've talked about interactive week a little bit. Before we get into this last question, we will be heading into Q&A after. So if anyone has any questions about Spanesi's training offerings, any specific sessions they'd like to see or a partner they'd like to see some sessions with, feel free to let us know in the questions and we can get to those in a minute. But Tim, you mentioned that Spanesi did the interactive week back in October. It was a great success. I tuned in for a couple of the sessions. It was really informative, very great stuff. But you built the studio to go along with that. And now you've got this fantastic studio that I hear you might be doing some stuff with in 2022.
Well, we already have booked, I think, through April with some exterior vendors. We have BASF, which we have a dry run with in the next hour or so, as soon as we're finished with this one here. We have other partners that we work with that are going to work with us. What we're doing with BASF is we're talking about blueprinting. We're talking about things that need to be done in the beginning of the repair process. It's one of the things that I've always said all along, and I even had a conversation about it this morning, is from the time it seems that sometimes in the body shop that the shop is not concerned about the refinish side of the business until the vehicle ends up in the preparation area for paint, where when that vehicle comes into the blueprinting process, there's certain things that could be done at that point to be able to either save some time in the preparation area prior to paint, or even being able to have the color pre-matched, so we're not having to do test panels and things of that nature when the vehicle gets there. It could already be pre-done because there's obviously some time that the paint technician has some downtime in between their booth cycles, that they could be doing some of those types of operations. So we're going to have a good conversation with BASF about that this afternoon and put together a live to do with that. We are also looking to work within the market in Canada right now with some of the local colleges and in the different segments of Canada. We did some pilots in 2021. Where our area manager up there in Canada, Constantino, has went into certain shops. We did in several areas where we went in, we did computerized measuring, we did pull up, we did some welding processes to try and help the schools get up to a level of education that would make the technician more attractive to the current body shops that are in their market area to be able to take care of some of the shortage of technicians and try and move them to the next level to be able to get out there in the, in the employment field. A lot of the stuff that we're trying to put together is not related just to our product. It's to support the industry.
Exactly. Yeah. You mentioned that like BASF session. I know you have some webinars you're planning to do as well. And obviously we mentioned at the beginning of the session, the one-on-one training, group training, all of those things are available through Spanesi's body shop on site. They've got all their equipment in. If you've seen their 360 tour that they shared last year, you can get a nice little glimpse into Spanesi Americas headquarters in Chicago there. So those are all our questions that we have, but we have had some people rolling through some questions as we've been speaking. So first of all, I just want to thank Tim for your expertise. Thank you for satisfying all of my questions that I've been asking about the industry and being a great source always.
Well, it's always fun to be able to, we seem to work well together.
You
come up with some very good questions and I could sit here and go off and, on it all day long, but sometimes you got to reel me back in, but
we really could. Tim and I could sit here and chat all day about different collision repair things. You could answer all of my questions, but now we'll answer your questions. So we've got Dana Alexander here asking if they're able to get some Spanesi measuring system in-depth training for a new technician. They do have a training video, but it is several years old.
Yes, actually, we should be launching the interactive course very soon. In between time, if you call 224 Spanesi, if you call our office, we can look to see where you're at. And we always have someone out and about that should be able to come in and help you. So not a problem. Or you can even send me an email directly at tmorgan@spaneziamericas.com. And that's Spanesi-Americas.com. And I'll respond and get it over to our training department and see what we can get put together for you.
We'll get that sorted out for you, Dana. They've also got somebody wondering if Spanesi plans to incorporate its video and interactive offerings into different training avenues.
We're always working with other entities of who may need training. So if there's a body shop group, we've consulted with some of them of, you know, trying to help them with some best practices training, or even put together some video for them, or whatever they need. Spanesi also, with their training department, has for the past five or six years gone out and we do shop evaluations to try and go through the facility to find out what's working, what's not working, point the shop owner, managers, technicians in the right direction of how they can improve their efficiencies. And I think this interactive format will allow us to be able to do that. All of our sessions that we do, like our interactive week, you can go to our YouTube page, and which is Spanesi Americas YouTube page. Those are all recorded there. So it's not like you have to always be with us live. And they're actually even been reintroduced on our Facebook page. So to answer that question, yes, we'll work with any industry segment. And we have a really good staff that can be able to put together what you may need. Our director of training is actually came to us from a car vehicle manufacturer. So he understands the engineering side of the business and everything that goes with that. So yes, we are open to discussion with anyone or any group of, you know, what we could offer when it comes to training.
Mm-hmm. So this is more of a question that I had that popped up. We've got, we've got a question. I'll ask my question after we get through some customer, some viewer questions, but this person says, I'm too busy with too many cars and my techs are overwhelmed. Does training really make a big difference if my staff are super seasoned? So, I mean, we know that the age in the collision repair industry in Canada and in the US is it's up there for the average age of the technician. A lot of people might think that their staff already know there is everything there is to know.
Well, I can tell you, I've been in this industry 46 years now. I learn something new about a vehicle every day. I spent a few hours last week having to do some research on a new vehicle that's going to be released. I think training opportunities are going to be there forever. If nothing was going to change in the industry, we'd all still be driving 57 Chevrolets. Everybody wants a 57 Chevrolet. Well, let's go back to the Model T. I actually happen to have a 1915 Model T truck in my garage. So if nothing was ever going to change in the industry, we'd be driving around on a bunch of wood bodies like mine.
That would be an interesting sight today. I would love to see some wood bodies.
The other thing when it comes to the training too is if through the training it makes my technician realize there's an easier process or a faster way to do something, I'm going to improve my, first of all, the quality of the repair, secondly the efficiency of the facility to being able to move the repair through the shop faster, which is going to save my labor time, which at the end sounds like I'm going to become more profitable.
Mm-hmm. 2 + 2 = 4. So my question that I had, we mentioned that you're partnering with different entities. You mentioned BASF and blueprinting and whatnot. Spanesi makes equipment, like you like have the Spanesi 360 philosophy, but you make equipment in all areas. So we can expect training in pretty much all of those areas.
Well, I don't think we're ever going to get to the point where we're going to teach somebody how to spray a car, because that's the paint company's job.
Yeah.
But yes, we will have training for welding, because of, you know, our products with spot welding and MIG welding. Even though we're using smart machines that are automatic, there still are some settings that you need to use and fine tune. So we want to be able to make sure that the technicians are up to speed on how to be able to do that. We're looking at even tutorials to be able to connect through a barcode on the side of a piece of equipment. You'd be able to hit that barcode and then be able to go to the manual for that particular product, or be able to go to a video of how to be able to operate that particular product as we grow in the future. There's so many different avenues that are out there. When we also talked about repair and replace, you can see in structural repair, today there is more replacement of panels than repair because of the steels or the materials that's being used in the design of the vehicle. So that's all going to require training. And then as I'm putting those panels on, are we using a universal fixturing system to be able to universally fixture the car, to be able to hold the part in place for welding, making sure there's no distortion? There's so much out there that hasn't always been covered that we want to try and move into and bring to the surface to be able to make facilities more efficient. Some people on this webinar may not realize Spanesi does own their own body shop in Italy and has since 1969. So we see in our own facility bottlenecks and different things that we need to turn around and solve. And so to do that, we, you know, this is what we need to do.
Yeah, you're not only hearing it from the body shops that you speak to and visit. I mean, you hear it from your actual body shop that's owned by the company.
Yes, exactly. And again, and we're in facilities every day. So we hear from people, you know, what their problems are. Mm-hmm. I was just in a shop last week and we were talking about parts carts. And it was like, well, yeah, parts carts. I mean, every job needs to have one, almost two per car, because what am I taking off that I have to replace? And what am I taking off that I have to put back on? And then bagging and tagging and, all, you know, here we go. I'm already off on blueprinting.
So many. I mean, yeah, exactly. Moving parts galore. That's, I mean, the collision repair industry philosophy. We've got another question here, I guess, since I name dropped your Spanesi 360 motto. Someone's asking what the Spanesi 360 philosophy actually entails. What does it mean?
Okay, when we look at the 360 process, our 360 process is we have tooling and processes for every part of the collision repair business. Mm-hmm. We manufacture our own spray booths, preparation areas, mix rooms. We have vacuum systems that are, you know, our own proprietary Spanesi vacuum systems. We have all the structural equipment for pulling and replacing panels, and obviously the welding. We have sanding vacuums. There's not a segment in the industry that we don't cover, and in fact, offer consulting, as I said, to be able to go in, look at the efficiencies of a facility, you know, maybe look at, okay, where do we need to come up with a better maintenance plan on equipment to be able to make our equipment last longer? Where do we have a problem piece of equipment that may need some repairs? Or are we actually using the equipment that's in our facility, or is it just sitting there not being used? Mm-hmm. And if there's something sitting there not being used and everybody's walking around it every day, why is it there? Let's get it out of here and let's get something in that's going to work.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. You hear a lot about people leaving equipment unused in corners and whatnot. And I think a lot of the times people are asking the question, well, how can I get to use it? Sometimes the answer really is just get rid of it, find a better tool and you'll relearn it again. But exactly. But yeah, so this means you got paint booths, you got the weld, you've listed it all. My personal favorite is your paint booths that are named after the artist there. I love them. All right. So if anyone has any other questions, please send them in now because we're about to wrap up here, but I'll just do my little closing preamble before the final questions we get in. Thank you everyone for tuning in today. Hopefully you learned something about all of these challenges we're facing today and how you can, you know, try to get your foot ahead of everything that we're about to face. And training is a huge part of that. And hopefully you reach out to Spanesi, explore their offerings. They've got plenty of stuff on their site, as Tim mentioned. Their interactive week. It's Spanesi-Americas.com. Tons of videos on their Facebook page as well, Spanesi Americas. And you can always reach out to them. What was the phone number again there, Tim?
224 Spanesi. So that's 224-772-6374.
Perfect. Alrighty. So I don't see any more questions coming in, but if anyone has anything after the fact, feel free to send myself an email. It's allison@mediamatters.ca, or you can reach out to Spanesi. I'm sure they're more than happy to answer your questions. But we thank you all for joining in.
Yeah. And absolutely. If anyone has any ideas of something they'd like to see, or if it's for your collision repair association or something like that, let us know, please, because we would love to be able to help out. We travel all over, speaking at many trade shows and many industry functions. And even if you're having a function and it's going to be, a virtual function, we would love to be able to be involved to help with education.
And where do people find out about upcoming classes or future classes that you're offering?
Go to our website and watch Collision Repair Magazine, because they always release the information first.
Yep, we've always got your back when it comes to training. So stay tuned to the site, sign up for our e-zine, and check out Spanesi's site as well. But thank you so much, Tim. It's always a pleasure chatting with you on here.
Okay, have a great day.
Yeah, have a great day, everyone. Bye-bye.